The University of Tennessee has many landmarks. This is one, Neyland Stadium, where more than 80,000 people come each week to watch the University of Tennessee and Cedar State University. I'm Margie Ison, and like over 500,000 people this year, I love to wear something orange and really be a part of the pageantry that is Tennessee football every week. It makes life much more enjoyable. And you know, it makes us all proud to know that Neyland Stadium, built without any tax dollars, has grown to become the fourth largest stadium on a college campus in America. Huell Hauser helps outline some of the history behind the home of the Vols.
On September the 11th, 1976, a new record was set in the state of Tennessee. On that date, over 80,000 football fans jammed Neyland Stadium to see UT's opening game of the season. The largest crowd ever to witness a football game in the state. This record, one of many established over the years in this historic, ever-growing stadium. It all began back in 1919 when Colonel W.S. Shields, a UT trustee, gave the university $22,000 to prepare and equip a playing field on a track of rough terrain south of the campus. It was between the hill and the Tennessee River. The university matched the Shields gift and the 7-acre track was purchased. For that initial gift and later support, the trustees voted to name the field in honor of the donor and his wife, Alice Watkins Shields. Starting on a positive note, the first game was played on the new field September the 24th, 1921 against Emory and Henry and was won by Tennessee 27-0. When General Bob Neyland became head coach in 1926, he immediately recommended expansion of the stadium. So when his first team played in 1926, 17 rows of concrete stands had been built on the east side, raising the capacity to 6,800 seats. And in 1929, even though the stadium had been enlarged again to seat over 17,000 people, a crowd estimated at 23,000 overflowed the stands and covered the end zones and the slopes to watch the Vols beat Alabama 6-0. Since 1929, 8 separate additions have been made to the stadium. The largest in 1948 when 18,000 seats were added. The phenomenal success of those Neyland teams had a lot to do with the additions in 1926, 1929, 1933 and 34, and again in 1948. Late in 1961, work began on perhaps the most spectacular addition to the stadium up to that time, a deck above the west stands, seating some 6,000 fans and topped by a mammoth press box 180 feet long. General Neyland didn't live to see the upper deck completed. He died in March of 1962. On October the 20th of that same year, some 51,500 fans crammed the stands as the university officially named the stadium, Neyland Stadium. The ceremonies were held before the UT-Alabama game. 14 years later, before the UT-Alabama game, another ceremony was held. With the members of the University Board of Trustees and Athletic Board in attendance on the field, the stadium, with its new upper deck completed, was rededicated. After the ceremonies, witnessed by a record crowd, Athletic Board Chairman Tom Elam commented on the newest addition to the stadium.
Mr. Elam, Neyland Stadium has come a long way.
It certainly has. From 3,200 people in 1921 to over 80,000 in 1976.
This is quite an accomplishment for the University of Tennessee, and it really shows the kind of support that the university has.
No question about it. There's not a nickel's worth of tax money in this stadium. It's all come from the people and from our supporters. It's incredible that we could do it on that basis.
Now, today there was a very special dedication ceremony. Exactly why were you dedicating the stadium today?
Well, we thought it appropriate to bring to the people of Tennessee the fact that this stadium is now the fourth largest in the United States, and it isn't very far behind Stanford and Ohio State. So this is, again, something the people of Tennessee have done, and the University of Tennessee has done, and all of us together has done. We think it appropriate. to tell the people of this great accomplishment and to remind them of what's going on right here in their state university.
Now, looking right up behind us there, that new section of the upper deck, that was something that's really added a lot of seats and has made us as large as we are.
That is correct. And furthermore, from the aesthetic standpoint, it has completely changed the looks of the stadium.
And another thing, standing down here on the sidelines, it's made it a lot louder in here on Saturday afternoon.
No question about it.
Surely, if there's any way to measure such things, Neyland Stadium, when filled, is first in the nation in crowd noise and enthusiasm. We know Neyland Stadium is now the fourth largest college football arena in the nation, with UT's home crowd attendance averaging fifth in the nation. It's a far cry from those early 1919 beginnings, but it's merely a continuation of the University of Tennessee's tradition of excellence.
College athletics means pressure for coaches, players, and fans. So it's really good that every now and then we have some type of outlet for those frustrations. Recently, the UT players watched and enjoyed one of the most famous country music songwriters and performers. It wasn't exactly the Grand Ole Opry stage. As a matter of fact, there was no stage at all. The kitchen was the backdrop at UT's Gibbs Hall dining room. However, the Vol players and the star, Tom T. Hall, and his famous troupe seemed to enjoy it even more.
Well, we looked down the road and we see the British drum, and there must have been 100 of them beating on the ground. The tip so high and it made the people ring. Rippers out of Knoxville and didn't say a thing. We fired our guns and the British kept a gun. There was 9 10 years, it was a while ago. Fire once more and they began to run down the Mississippi to the Gulf of Mexico. Well, old Hickory said we could take them back to fire. If we don't find what to do, we'll look them in the eyes. So we held our side and we didn't see them well. Open up a program and see them get well. We fired our guns and the British kept a gun.
Story about an old man I met down in Florida, and he had a great philosophy of life, and this is what I want to do tomorrow when I'm an old man. How old do you think I am, he said. And I said, well, man, I didn't know. He said, you know, I turned 65 about 11 months ago. And I was sitting in Miami pouring blended whiskey down when this old gray white gentleman was mean enough to lie. Well, there wasn't anyone around except this old man and me. And the guy that ran the bar was watching Ironsides on TV. And uninvited, he sat down and he opened up his mind. Our old dogs and children and watermelon wine. Have you ever had a drink of watermelon wine? He had. Lord, he told me all about it, though I didn't answer back. He said, son, ain't but three things in this world that's worth a solitary day. But old dogs and children and watermelon wine. Boy, I had to catch a plane up to Atlanta that next day. As I left for my room, I saw him picking up my chin. And that night, I dreamed in peaceful sleep of shady summertime. Old dogs and children and watermelon wine.
These guys make a lot of money and travel a lot of places, and they're not getting a whole lot of money tonight, but if you were paid by appreciation, you'd all be millionaires on tonight's work, and we really appreciate it, do we?
Yeah!
You know, our campus at the university is the state of Tennessee. And UT Athletics is a common bond that helps tie the state and the people together to make life a little more enjoyable for your family and mine, to make us all a little prouder to be from Tennessee.